Mission Impossible has always been known for its death-defying stunts. But in the series' most recent entries, the set pieces went to a whole new level. Stunt Coordinator and Second Unit Director Wade Eastwood has been integral to the groundbreaking stunts of Mission Impossible since Rogue Nation. He sat down with us to discuss how the biggest stunts of Christopher McQuarrie's installments were achieved and what we can expect from Dead Reckoning. This is How They Shot It, Mission Impossible. Before we get started, remember to subscribe to StudioBinder and click the bell to get notifications for all of our filmmaking videos. We'll use StudioBinder's shot list to look at some of the crew's technical choices.
3, 2, 1.
As a stunt coordinator, Eastwood oversees the execution of stunts from beginning to end.
Certain films, you'll come on as a script and there'll be action, there is a car chase and be quite detailed, and you'll rehearse it and deliver it. The movies that I do aren't that way. We have characters that need to get from point A to B, and we have to come up with a sequence that gets them and most visually stunning and challenging way of getting from point A to B. And that's just how we do it. So I get involved very early on in the movie, months or even a year out. So there's a lot of involvement to get all those boxes ticked.
Of course, above all else, a stunt coordinator ensures no one gets hurt.
My job is to eliminate the risk. So look at the sequence as a whole and see what I can do to deliver the best visual sequence and make it look as dangerous as possible, but not be as dangerous as possible.
For Eastwood and many other stunt coordinators, the role of second unit director feels like a natural extension of their coordinator duties.
Being a second unit director and stunt coordinator is very common these days. You basically get to control more on your action. So you start as a stunt performer. You've been involved in the setup of a lot of different stunts, and you've got the desire and the passion to lead a team and to create action. You become a stunt coordinator. And then if you really understand camera and character, then you become a second unit director / stunt coordinator. So you still have your team. I've got an amazing team. I couldn't do it without them. But I just get to therefore create the action and also shoot the action with my second unit, with my cinematographer that understands my pace, because I shoot very fast, and my first AD that understands how to run the set at that speed and safety and everything. And you just have your team and it's like a family, and you go off and you deliver.
But being a stunt coordinator on Mission Impossible is unique because of one man, Tom Cruise.
It really is you. I've heard stories. They can't all be true.
It's super important that people recognize the difference between a stunt performer doing a piece of action, a trained world-class motocross rider coming in and crashing a bike or jumping it, and then someone like a Tom Cruise doing it.
Don't be careful, be confident. Be confident.
We got to get him competent enough that he can do the stunt, and then he's going to find the journey of the character and deliver that to the stunt. He's got to act it so that we feel the tension of the moment, whatever it is, the jeopardy, and we feel the performance.
For Eastwood and the rest of the Mission Impossible team, a truly awesome stunt is one which isn't simply impressive, it's one which is driven by character.
The thing about Ethan is he doesn't think first and act. The character acts then thinks.
I'm on the plane! Open the door!
How did you get in the plane?
Not in the plane! I'm on the plane! Open the door!
Someone falls in the river. A kid falls in the river. I'm not going to think twice. A split second, I don't care. I'm in the river. And I've got to rescue the kid. And then we might be getting dragged towards a waterfall or where, and you're like, oh, I didn't think about that. And that's very much Ethan. That's why I think we can relate to it. He has to save the world, has to save the person, and he jumps in no matter what. And then he's like, oh shit, now what do I do? And I think people can really relate to it and relate to him.
Hey.
When Eastwood joined the Mission Impossible team for Rogue Nation, he was tasked with an extremely complex sequence, hanging Tom Cruise off the side of a plane. And it wasn't just any plane. The team would be using the military-grade Airbus A400M, which would fly up to 5,000 feet in the air at over 180 miles per hour for nearly 8 minutes.
We wanted the audience to just be on that journey, like feel the runway, you know, the sort of steep takeoff. And it was a lot of approval process to get a camera on the side of a plane. We had to build a very special rig and get all sorts of approvals. You can imagine this military aircraft. And, you know, we had the aircraft for 2 days. We had a day to rig and prep and rehearse and a day to shoot. That's all we were given. Tom rehearsed, and apart from having a bird strike or something that could have hit him on the outside of the plane, we did all we could to prevent that happening. But, you know, it's a stunt at the end of the day. Something could always happen.
Cruz was attached to the plane with a harness that was removed in post. And he wore special contacts in case of debris. The team filmed the sequence on an Arri 35mm camera with a Panavision anamorphic zoom lens, which was housed in a Netman System stabilized head in order to prevent a shaky image. They shot the scene 8 times before they got what they wanted. Another jaw-dropping stunt from Rogue Nation was its lengthy underwater scene.
We previewed the shots, and the scene was, you know, he's drowning. The more we got into, we want to hold the shot longer so the audience are taking a breath with you. You know, when you go and watch those underwater movies, you end up taking a breath with you, and your heart starts going. And that's really what they wanted, McHugh and Tom wanted.
Cruz was attached to a spinning rig, and the camera was placed on a track to create the illusion that Ethan was being thrust around the Taurus. Although this movement was simulated, Cruz holding his breath was very real.
We got to hold the shot longer. We're not moving the camera, so we're not doing a little cheat past him where it looks like a wonder and we're doing a little morph or a little, you know, blend. He's there in frame, so there's no blend, there's no morph, there's no CG. Well, how do we do it? Well, we just got to have to hold his breath longer. So we start the training process, you know, baby steps, and we do it until 1.5 minutes becomes 2.5, becomes 4, becomes 5, you know, so just keep going.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 3, 2, 3.
For Fallout, Eastwood and the crew raised the bar once more. Cruz became the first actor to do a Halo jump on camera. Halo stands for High Altitude, Low Opening, and is designed for undercover military missions, where a skydiver will open their parachute below 2,000 feet in order to not be detected. Executing the stunt meant lots of practice.
Multiple hundred jumps. The body's going through a lot. And you see it when, you know, skydivers working with Tom, cameraman, guys with like 15,000 jumps, you know, 16,000, 18,000 jumps. But then, you know, when Tom's like, yeah, that's not it, let's go again. And they're thinking, are you serious? We've done 10 already. Like, I was all gung ho. And then slowly it's like, yeah, I think that was the shot. Don't you think that was the shot? I think we got the shot. And he's like, no, I don't think so. He's just ready to go, as if it's the first take.
Aerial sequences like this one were shot on a Panavision DXL. The jump took place at night, so the team specially designed a helmet which lit Cruz's face. To capture the jump, a stunt camera operator followed Cruz with a camera attached to his helmet. The operator needed to pull focus by eye, and Cruz needed to hit his marks in midair. The jump sequence was split into 3 parts. The initial jump, the flips, and the oxygen tank transferal. It was a demanding shoot.
It was at night. Tom had to fly up to him within a sort of, you know, 1.5, 2 foot of the lens, and stop there at, you know, 30,000 feet. The physicality of what Tom does is immense. I mean, he really does commit physically to these roles.
Another highly complicated stunt sequence in Fallout was the helicopter scene, which begins with Cruz outside the helicopter and then flying it himself.
We wanted to do a helicopter chase, you know, that we thought there hasn't really been a great one in film for many, many years. And we wanted to do something different, again, shoot it more subjectively, not 2 helicopters, but objectively from another camera ship. Probably one of the biggest challenges on the helicopter sequence in Fallout was when Tom drops to the ball. normally that would be done on a studio backlot with a hanging helicopter gimbal off a crane and a ball with the rigs, the wire rigs, all through the helicopter gimbal and down to the ground with a nice descender and everyone on the ground with a cup of coffee. We, in mission style, had to do that 2,000 foot off the ground in a real helicopter. An A-Star, a Squirrel helicopter, is not big. So we had to design a special rig that could do a compound of wires and cables. And I was leaning out the helicopter. They actually had to remove me. I was leaning out giving commands and cues to my riggers in the helicopter and to Tom. And the line had to be flaked in a way that it, when he dropped, wouldn't catch and tangle, you know, because it would rip him apart. So that was hugely challenging. When you see Tom let go of that helicopter, he's in free fall. He drops the 40 foot down to that ball and he hits that ball hard in the film, you know, and even if you make it a bit soft, it's still hard. I always try and make stunts that aren't so dangerous, but look dangerous. But with missions, we tend to always end up doing stunts that are really, really dangerous. And sometimes the audience would never really know how dangerous they are or how much skill you need in order to do it so it's not dangerous. The amount of training to do that, you know, a lot of people can fly helicopters. A lot of people can fly helicopters in the mountains. If I was doing that, you know, I'm obviously looking out the cockpit, I'm flying, I'm pitching the nose, I'm watching my rotor RPM, I'm hearing the noise, and that's all I'm focused on. But in a situation like that, Tom is doing that and thinking, and when he landed, he told me, he's like, oh, I just thought if I did one more turn that way, I could get the light flaring perfectly when I deliver that look or that line. You think, how are you thinking about that? You know, I was just hoping you were looking at your dials, but he can't just look at his dial because then the audience are just looking at Tom Cruise's or Ethan Hunt just looking at the cockpit, and he can't. He's going to sell it to us, the jeopardy of the situation, and that is the very, very difficult thing to do.
Whoa, too much.
Figuring out the stunts was only half the battle.
If we can't capture it in the right way, then there's no point in doing the sequence. So we had to develop, again, specific pieces of equipment unique to this film. There's a lot goes on behind the scenes. If the shot looks dramatic in the cinema, believe me, the behind the scenes is five times more dramatic.
Really well done. Yeah, everyone, good. The whole team.
You guys did a great job.
Oh, look at that. You just see the close-up. Look at that.
You did an average job too, though.
Yeah, average. It's
pretty average.
That's all I want. As long as I just average.
Consistently average.
Just, I don't mind.
People are chasing us.
Yes, they are. You're driving.
Dead Reckoning continues to push the boundaries of stunt work. Perhaps the most complex and dangerous sequence from the newest entry is the bike cliff jump.
Yeah, the cliff jump came about. Tom's always wanted to do a base jump, and he loves motorbikes. So why not ride a motorbike off a cliff and do both in one go? We wrote in this chase sequence on a bike that he ends up at the top of the cliff and worked out all the parameters. We did a lot of rehearsal on this. We had built our own motocross track, and Tom was doing motocross all day. I mean, he would go skydive in the morning or skydive in the afternoon, depending on the weather, and then motocross the opposite. If he's motocross in the morning, it's skydive in the afternoon. And we had the helicopter next to the motocross track, so we'd do motocross, finish the bike, get in the helicopter, go up, and just do tracking runs with the team, just getting perfect tracks.
That's what we do.
I mean, we're talking hundreds of jumps on the motorbike too, until he was so competent at both. And then we put everything together.
Oh, it's gonna be fun.
Oh, it's great.
Capturing the stunt was equally complicated.
We did all sorts of crazy stuff, you know? I mean, we put cameras on motorbikes with selfie sticks out the front. We wanted to try and be right there where he came off, so we had to have the drone right there, and obviously if he hit that, we're in trouble.
The team charted out the trajectory of Cruise and the bike during multiple test runs so that they could place the cameras in the right areas.
I set up a proxy rehearsal, a simulation of exact arc with cables, and we put the drones there, and we had little GPS trackers, and we measured so that out of 50 jumps, this was our path, within a meter of this path, so we could put the drone right there. Then it would be perfect. But, you know, obviously, he's got to ride the bike off the mountain as Ethan, so he's got to forget that he's just riding a motorbike as a base jumper. Then he's got to make sure the bike doesn't break down. If the bike sputtered before the end of the ramp, we're in serious trouble. If the crosswind comes and blows him off the ramp, we're in very serious trouble. He has to come off the ramp, see these cameras right in front of him, but believe he's not going to hit them, not look at them. He's got to separate from the bike without getting caught up in it when it rotates. Then he's got to do the perfect track away from the bike and the cliff, have the perfect delay time for opening. And then once he opens, make sure he hasn't got a line twist or a line over or anything like that, so he doesn't turn and go straight back into the mountain, then he can, you know, get a clean exit out and fly into the valley. So again, in the movie, everyone goes, but really there are so many other things going on that the audience won't be aware of to make that wow factor. And yeah, he delivered. Was in my 32 years the first time I've had an emotional onset moment, for sure. It was breathtaking.
Wade Eastwood's work on the Mission Impossible franchise illustrates the power of a great stunt coordinator and second unit director. Stunts are all about preparation. The more prepared you are, the better and safer the stunt. Start planning your next great action sequence with StudioBinder's storyboard software. For the complete interview with Wade Eastwood, go to the description for a link to our StudioBinder Academy channel, where you can also find long-form content and product tutorials. And remember to subscribe and click the bell to stay up to date on all of StudioBinder's filmmaking videos. That's all for now. We have to run. This video will self-destruct in 5 seconds.